Okay, my dear budding doctors, I welcome you all to my new YouTube channel, Americo's Notes. In this channel, we'll be discussing the repeatedly asked question and must know questions before appearing for the university exam for first year MBBS students. So today, let's start with the important 4-mark question in general anatomy, and tomorrow we'll be discussing the important 2-mark question, and then we'll pass on to the upper limb, lower limb, thorax, abdomen, head and neck. Okay, so let's start today. For that, let me tell you 2 important points to know before going to write your anatomy exams. So first, focus on diagrams, because doctors, diagrams are very, very important in anatomy, and diagrams yield you marks in anatomy. The more diagrams you draw, the more mark you're going to get, okay? And also, these diagrams help us to remember the points related to the question. So it's very important to practice the diagrams. Second important point is learn key points. Don't sit and mug up everything given in the book. Learn the key points, okay? Learn the important points. You should draw the diagram, write the key points, keep revising the key points, okay? The more you revise, the more you'll remember, okay? So these are the 2 important points I must tell you before appearing for the exam. So these are the chapter wise important questions in general anatomy, and let's start. So the first 4-mark we are going to see is the pronation and supination. Pronation: when palm faces backwards or downwards, as in picking food with fingers from the plate, is called pronation. Second point is these are special movements which occur only at radioulnar joints. Third point, you can draw the diagram which is given in BD Chaurasia, page 18, figure 1.17. The first diagram is the pronation. Second, supination: here, when the palm is facing forwards or upwards, as in putting food in the mouth, is called supination. Second point, you can add the same point as these are special movements which occur only at radioulnar joints. Third, you can draw the diagram which is given in BD Chaurasia, page 18, the same figure 1.17, the second diagram. That is the supination diagram. So that's it for the first question. So the second question is the blood supply of long bones. Blood supply of long bones is provided by 4 arteries: nutrient artery, periosteal arteries, epiphyseal arteries and metaphyseal arteries. So first of all, what you can do is draw the diagram which is given in the second chapter, figure 2.13. You can see the diagram here. This diagram you can draw first of all, okay? Then you can start explaining the answer. So first is the nutrient artery. Nutrient artery enters the shaft through the nutrient foramen, runs obliquely through the cortex and divides into ascending and descending branches in the medullary cavity. Second point is that it divides into a number of small parallel channels. Third point, you can write the supply, okay? The nutrient artery supplies the medullary cavity, inner 2/3 of cortex and metaphyses. Third, you can write about the direction of nutrient foramen. So it is directed away from the growing end of the bone. So this is enough for the first one, nutrient artery. Next, periosteal arteries. Periosteal arteries are especially numerous beneath the muscular and ligamentous attachment. Next is, they ramify beneath the periosteum and enter the Volkmann's canal to supply the outer 1/3 of cortex. Third is the epiphyseal arteries. Here, these are derived from the periarticular vascular arcades and are found on non-articular bony surface. Next is, out of the numerous vascular foramen in the region, only a few admit the arteries. Third is, the number and size of the foramina may give an idea to the vascularity of the two ends of the long bone. Fourth is the metaphyseal arteries. It is derived from the neighboring systemic vessels, and then they pass directly into the metaphyses and reinforce the metaphyseal branches from the primary nutrient artery. Next, you can write about the nerve supply of bones. Here, just a point, okay, that the nerves accompany the blood vessels and most of them are sympathetic and vasomotor in function. So that's it for the second question. The third question is the ossification of bones. First point, bones are initially laid down as mesodermal condensation. The conversion of these mesodermal condensation into bone is called as mesenchymal or intramembranous ossification, and the bones are called as membrane bones. However, during certain times, mesodermal stage may pass through a cartilaginous stage during second month of intrauterine life, and this conversion of cartilaginous model into bone is called as endochondral or intracartilaginous ossification, and these bones are called as cartilaginous bones. So usually the ossification takes place at the center of ossification, and the center of ossification may be primary or secondary. The primary center appears before birth and the secondary center appears after birth. Now let's see this diagram. Here first picture a cartilage is given, then calcification has taken place, primary center of ossification has developed, then the secondary center of ossification has developed, and then a mature bone is formed. Here primary center forms diaphysis and the secondary center forms the epiphysis. The fusion of epiphysis with diaphysis starts at puberty and is completed by 25 years of age. Next, the law of ossification is given. It states that the secondary center of ossification which appear first are the last to unite. Next, let's see 2 points on the clinical anatomy of ossification. First one, a defect in membranous ossification causes a rare syndrome called cleidocranial dysostosis, and it is characterized by 3 cardinal features. First one is the varying degree of aplasia of the clavicle. Second one is the increase in transverse diameter of the cranium. And third one is the retardation in fontanel ossification. Next defect is in the endochondral ossification, which causes a common type of dwarfism called achondroplasia, in which the limbs are short but the trunk is normal. So that's it for this question. So the next question is the cartilage. So the definition of cartilage is that it is a connective tissue composed of cells and fibers embedded in a firm gel-like matrix which is rich in mucopolysaccharide. So next let's see the general features of the cartilage. So the cartilage has no blood vessels or lymphatics. Then it has no nerves and therefore it is insensitive. Third, the cartilage is surrounded by a fibrous membrane called perichondrium. And the fourth, when the cartilage calcifies, the chondrocytes die and the cartilage is replaced by a bone-like tissue. So next, let's see the comparison of the 3 types of cartilage. So first, the hyaline cartilage, its location. It's seen in the articular cartilages of long bone, sternum and the ribs. And the color is bluish-white and the appearance is translucent. And the fibers are very thin and it is very flexible. So next, the fibrocartilage. It is seen in the intervertebral disc of pubic symphysis, temporomandibular joints and sternoclavicular joints. It is glistening white in color and it is opaque appearance. And it has numerous white fibers and it is the strongest of all the 3 cartilages. Next, the elastic cartilage. It is seen in the pinna, external auditory meatus, eustachian tubes and epiglottis. It is yellow in color and it has opaque appearance and it has numerous yellow fibers. Then it is the most flexible of the 3 cartilage. So that's it for the cartilage. Next question is epiphysis. First, the definition. The ends and tip of a bone which ossify from secondary centers are called epiphysis. After writing the definition, you can draw the diagram which is given here and mark the parts. Next, let's go to the type of epiphysis. First one is a pressure epiphysis. It takes part in the transmission of weight. Example, head of femur. Next is the traction epiphysis. It does not take part in the transmission of weight but provide attachment to one or more tendon which exert a traction on epiphysis. Example is the tubercle of humerus. Next is the atavistic epiphysis, which is phylogenetically an independent bone which in man becomes fused to another bone. Example is the coracoid process of scapula. Then is the aberrant epiphysis, which is not usually present. After writing the type of epiphysis, you can draw the diagram which is given here and mark the type of epiphysis. So that's it for the epiphysis. So the next important question is a classification of joints. In this question, they'll ask to classify the joints and they'll ask to explain any one of the joints, like explain fibrous joint or explain cartilaginous joint or explain synovial joint. The question will be like that, okay? So let's see this question together. First, fibrous joints. In fibrous joints, the bones are joined by fibrous tissue. These joints are either immovable or permit slight degree of movement, and they are grouped into the following subtypes. First one is sutures, next one is syndesmosis, and the third one is gomphosis. So first, sutures. These are peculiar to skull and are immovable, and the sutures can be of the following types. And in figure 3.6, the types of sutures is given. So you can draw the diagram and give an example for that. First one, plain suture. Example is internasal suture. Second, serrate. Example is interparietal suture. Third, squamous. Example is temporoparietal suture. Fourth, denticulate. Example is lambdoid suture. Fifth, skin dialysis type. Example is between the rostrum of sphenoid and upper border of vomer. Next, a small note on fontanelles is given. So, the specific points on sutures in newborn skull are membrane-filled gaps called fontanelles, and they allow the underlying brain to increase in size. Anterior fontanelle is used to judge the hydration of infant, and all these fontanelles become bone by 18 months of age. So, next, syndesmosis. The bones are connected by interosseous ligament. Here example is the inferior tibiofibular joint. In figure 3.8, you can see that. So you can draw the diagram and give an example. Third one is gomphosis. So here the example is root of tooth in its bony socket. In figure 3.9, you can see the example. Cartilaginous joints. This type of joints, the bones are joined by cartilage, and there are two types of it. The first is the primary cartilaginous joint, and the next one is the secondary cartilaginous joint. Primary cartilaginous joint, the bones are united by a plate of hyaline cartilage so that the joint is immovable and very strong. These joints are temporary because after certain years of age, the cartilaginous plate is replaced by a bone. Example is the joint between epiphysis and diaphysis of a growing long bone. The next one is the secondary cartilaginous joint. These are called the fibrocartilaginous joint. And here the articular surfaces are covered by a thin layer of hyaline cartilage and then united by a disc of fibrocartilage. These joints are permanent and they persist throughout their life. Secondary cartilaginous joint permit only limited movements due to the pad fibrocartilage it bears. Example is pubic symphysis. Synovial joints. These are the most mobile type of joints. The articular surfaces are covered with hyaline cartilage, and the surface of the cartilage, there is a joint cavity filled with synovial fluid. The synovial fluid helps in the lubrication of the joints. The joint is then surrounded by an articular capsule lined by a synovial membrane. Because of its rich nerve supply, the capsule is very sensitive to stretches caused by movements and creates a reflex which protects it from any sprain. This is called the watchdog action of the capsule. So next is the classification of synovial joints and their movements. So the first type of joint is plane type. Movement is gliding movement. Example is intermetacarpal joints and intercarpal joints, intermetatarsal joints and intertarsal joints. Next one is the uniaxial joint. It has two types, hinge joint and pivot joint. Hinge joint movement is flexion and extension. An example is the elbow joint and ankle joint. Next one, pivot joint, the movement is rotation, and the example is superior and inferior radioulnar joints. Third is biaxial joint. It has two types, condylar joint and ellipsoid joint. Condylar joint movement is flexion and extension. Example is knee joint. And ellipsoid joint movement is flexion, extension, abduction and adduction. Example is wrist joint. Fourth one is multiaxial joints. So the first is saddle joint. It has the movements of flexion and extension, abduction, adduction. Example is sternoclavicular joint and first carpometacarpal joint. Next one is ball and socket joint. It has the movements of flexion and extension, abduction and adduction, circumduction and rotation. An example is shoulder joint and hip joint. So that's it for today. Thank you for listening. Tomorrow we'll continue with the important must know 2 marks of general anatomy. So till then, bye bye.